It is incredible that today we have the Jenny lecture. We have Luis Moreno Campo to give the lecture. For me, this is an incredible occasion. I have basically followed the work of Moreno Campo for a long time. I'm really much of an admirer of him. He's one of my heroes. He was the prosecutors of the Junta trials in 1985 in my country, in Argentina, and then he was in the last decade the first chief prosecutor in the International Criminal Court. In addition to that, I have to say, and this is just a side issue, that when I was researching for my last book, I went to the archives of Memoria Abierta, one of the most important human rights archives in Argentina, and perhaps the most important archive was the Moreno Campo archive, which is the material from the Junta trials that he donated. So there are so many levels in which I have read and follow his work, and now also I was able to see the internal workings of the prosecutor's office, and I even realized even more all the things that he know and how he was able to intellectually project them in terms of establishing a real powerful connection between history and justice, first in Argentina and later on the world stage with his work in the International Criminal Court. I will stop there because we should take advantage of his presence here and listen to him, not to me. So I will move away now, and thank you so much for being here.
Who of you were not here yesterday to see? You were not here. Oh, so we need a movie. Okay. We'll try to see if we can show some images, because images are better. Who of you are not studying history? And many of you. What are you guys? What are you studying?
International affairs.
All of you, international affairs.
Creative writing.
Writing. Great. I like that. I need that. Public policy. It's coming. Okay. My idea is I'm taking advantage of his presence and people like you. More than to give a lecture, I'd like to share with you what I feel is the biggest problem we have. And it's connected. Yesterday we show this movie about genocide, how genocide was created, the world was created first, and then adopted the convention, and now have a court implementing it. And that was interesting for me because there were one New York Times article criticizing the film, saying, okay, again about genocide. It's enough. Genocide is a crime. What's the big deal about this? And other journalists saying, oh my God, this is so naive, so idealistic. And I feel that's exactly the problem I see. For some people, genocide is clearly a crime, should not happen, and it happened, someone had to stop it and control it. And for others, this idea to have law in international relations is crazy. International relations is about relation between states in a illegal or in a lawless world. And I think that's the problem. The audience are disconnected. And in some way, the disciplinary studies are increasing the disconnection. Because if you are a lawyer, lawyers, in particular criminal lawyers, assume the law apply. And for that, move. But this is the main problem. The law is not clear it's applying. And for international relations people, the law does not apply. So they feel it's a mistake that someone is trying to implement the law. And that's why I was thinking historians could help here. Because you have blessed dogmatic principle, you are trying to understand what happened, And that's what we need for, we need history of today. No, history of what's happening today. That, for me, is the approach we need. Because it's not, it's a disconnection. I plan to present, and you can imagine, the Nuremberg trial, and I was trying to present how shocking it was that. Because normally, criminal law is applied by prosecutors and judges representing a community. Could be a county, a state, or even a national community. But Nuremberg was for the first time in history that prosecutors and judges were representing the entire humanity. And that is a different scale, you know? And that, I think, is the moment where things change. And was completely unexpected for everyone. Something interesting about what we think about our legal our scholar studies is no one was thinking on Nuremberg. Just happened. There was a political decision to apply criminal law, and there were skillful lawyers managing to invent solutions for that. But in fact, some of the crimes they presented, they charged, including aggression crime and crimes against humanity, were never a crime described by the law. There was no international treaty describing them as a law. So for many European countries in particular, and civil law tradition, that was wrong. You cannot invent the law. The law had to be before, then you can predict. So it was a really complicated professional activity. And so they were prosecuting the leaders as soon as the war ended. Was completely difficult. And in fact, in some way, promote new knowledge, new theories, new ideas, including in different areas. For me, the most impressive thing at Nuremberg is this idea that prosecutors and judges represent humanity. I was discussing with an architect how to present Nuremberg. And he said, of course, you got to present the headphones. Why the headphones? Because the first time in IBM developed the headphones for the Nuremberg trial. They were not headphones before. So for him, Nuremberg is about headphones. And that's in some way, we our knowledge define our understanding. And the Nuremberg prosecutor was telling the judges very clearly, this time you applied the law to the people who lost the war. But you have to be clear that this law could apply even against yourselves, against your countries. So for the prosecutor, it was clearly, it's the law. The trial was about establishing a new law in the world. Not everyone, even in the US, was in agreement with him. Other people think, okay, we're just punishing in a civilized way the bad guys, but international relations still is about friends and enemies. And in particular, because they had a Cold War coming. And that's why, in particular, the US did not like to highlight what happened in Germany a lot, because they need Germany on their side to fight the Russians. So basically, this idea of global law, a law that beyond the national state, that was until this moment the basic idea, was not really coming for. I have another beautiful video that also you can imagine with Eleanor Roosevelt. Eleanor Roosevelt was the only woman in the UN General Assembly in 1948, the only one, and she presented the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, was all the states agree on this idea, to have their universal human rights. Until that moment, rights were national. So the states were providing rights to the citizens. 1948, the idea was they are universal. But where is the universal government to enforce these universal rights? None. So that was the beginning of something very, it's an ideal, is important because it's defining the horizons, but if it's not happening, there's no mechanism to enforce them. Okay? So 1945, 1948 was this beginning. It's a new era, it's universal, it's global, but it's not real enforcement. But for me, interestingly, these ideas create traction. Because what happened is, even if it was not possible to build at the global level any operation, there were operations at the national level. And that's why he liked me, because when I was 32, and I like to have a picture, I was a young one, I had a video too, you can imagine the video. It's coming.
He's coming, he's coming.
Yeah, eventually we'll show. Okay. Then we can repeat
that. 5 minutes.
Okay. What happened is, in few countries, in Greece and Portugal, but then in Argentina in 1985, the national system start to apply the law to people who normally were above the law. That was unexpected too. Not because formally it was prohibited. No, formally it was accepted, but never happened. In Argentina, no constitutional government ended its term after 1928. So since 1928, constantly we had a coup d'etat throwing out the leaders. So the army commanders who did it, they were not afraid to be prosecuted because they were the power. And suddenly, in 1985, we prosecuted them. And suddenly, we applied the law to these leaders. And was again totally unexpected to them. And and it's more than was shocking, was really unexpected. This is the same. I have another video showing Nuremberg. At Nuremberg were first a big trial with judges and prosecutors from four different countries, Russia, US, UK, and France. But then there were 12 subsequent trials were just American lawyers and American judges and prosecutors. I had a picture of one of them, a video of one of them, showing a group of people who were killing Jewish, Einsatz group. And you see, the commander, he is on trial, he's providing testimony, and he confessed that since 41 and 42, in 1 year, he personally conducted the execution, the killing of 90,000 persons. He recognized that. Bam. Yeah, I execute 90,000 persons. Because for him it was unexpected to be responsible for that, because for him it was just his job. It was he received instructions, he did it, and that's it. So he had no idea that he could be liable before a criminal court. So my point is, all this was happening and no one was predicting. No one can say this will happen. And to keep moving, end of the Cold War, when the Cold War ended, President Bush and President Clinton were announcing a new era. And in fact, it was a new era when Iraq invaded Kuwait for the first time, Security Council was acting together against the Iraq invasion. But it was a classic idea. Invasion of a different country is a classic idea. It's prohibited, and then they were together, no Iraq. But no one was predicting international courts again. And what happened is that in 1993, Europe was shocked by these pictures of people in concentration camps, similar to what happened in Germany. And no one knew what to do. And then one of the ideas was, okay, we were back to create Nuremberg. And they created the Yugoslavia Tribunal. The International Criminal Tribunal for Yugoslavia was created by the Security Council. US was thinking, we'll do this to put pressure. It's a different way to negotiate. And they will provide no money. It was a complicated beginning. And 1994, Rwanda genocide happened. 1 million people killed in 3 months. So the world cannot ignore that. So the world decided, Security Council decided to create another tribunal, the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda. And because the Balkans was still grant ongoing, the discussion was still ongoing, and then in 1998 was a momentum where the world discussed the creation of a permanent international criminal court. And it's interesting because, again, no one was really thinking of that. Clinton, for the first time, talked about this in 1997. And he was talking about the court who will open investigation when the Security Council decides to open investigation. So it was not a real justice in terms of applying the law. It was just a court investigating those that the Security Council considered enemies. That's it. Are you the IT guy?
I am.
Great. Okay, I think I'll not turn off this, and then it's still... Okay. So, in 1998, 160 states from all over the world sit together to discuss the creation of a permanent international criminal court. And it was a big debate because U.S. was trying to impose the idea that this court should act just at the request of Security Council. And in a very interesting moment, Europe, Latin America, and Africa played together, plus Canada and Australia, played, and UK, very important, played together to go beyond that and say, no, we need a real court. Because the court that relies on Security Council will never act. Because Security Council is always protecting a friend. And they succeeded. And they adopted the Convention for 120 Bombs. And in 2002, there were more than 60 countries that ratified the treaty. And in 2003, 18 judges and the prosecutor was appointed. And we got to manage this. And what happened was many people were expecting that the court would not work. I remember I was at Harvard teaching in those days, and
for the United States of America. The privilege of opening the first trial in history for crimes against the peace of the world imposes a grave responsibility. The wrongs which we seek to condemn and punish have been so calculated, so malignant and so devastating that civilization cannot tolerate their being ignored because it cannot survive their being repeated.
So he's representing civilization, and he's not talking about values, he's talking about survival. He understood it's about survival. And I have not a film, but he says something that those who study international relations should really take into consideration. He say, we can help relations between states focusing on individual criminal responsibility. Because that's the only way to change behavior of a country. Without that, we are between frustration or war. That's it. And his idea was to focus on individual responsibility of the head of states to make this a change in the international scenario. No one followed him, even no one is quoting him on that. No one listens to prosecutors apparently, except you, Federico. No one. Let me show you, this is one of the different member trial.
I became the chief prosecutor for the United States in what was certainly the biggest murder trial in human history.
We asked
the same guy, 26.
To affirm by international penal action man's right to live in peace and dignity, regardless of his race or creed. The case we present is a plea of humanity to law.
Where did Group D operate? Group D operated in the Dutch Ukraine. Do you know how many persons were liquidated by Einsatz Group D and the other direction?
And in your direction?
From Juli 1941 bis Juli 1942 sind von den Einsatzkommandos etwa 90.000 als liquidiert gemeldet worden.
So he has, for him was so incredible, but he recognized what he did. 90,000 people. And as I say, Cold War stop this. Ah, no, I have a little rule.
We stand today at the threshold of a great event, both in the life of the United Nations and in the life of mankind. This Universal Declaration of Human Rights may well become the international Magna Carta of all men everywhere.
I think what's happening is the technology, including radio and movies in those days, are providing more voice to normal people, and they are requesting rights. But fighting with state apparatus who are basically controlled by people in power, and they like to control power. And that's a continuous fight, and now increased by the new technologies. But for me, the interesting point is she was representing a new ideas, the idea that it would be universal rights, but she was not able to create any state for that, or any state activity, any public system. And though they are right, but nothing happened if someone violated the rights. And that in some way is a system of UN. In 2010, the Security Council was celebrating the 10th anniversary of Resolution 1350, mm-hmm. establishing the need to have women as mediators in conflicts. And I talked to the ambassador saying, look, it's a great idea, but we are celebrating the resolution, 10 years, but they never appointed a woman. Would be great to put pressure now to really, after 10 years, appoint a woman. And Darfur is the perfect case, because in Darfur, we have a genocide by rape. And the ambassador told me, oh, it's a great idea. It's a great idea, but we cannot do it. Why not? Because that's a rule. In the UN, when we talk about principles, we don't talk about the facts. If we talk about the facts, we don't talk about the principles. That is insane. So it's about principles. It's, we know it's the horizon, we go there. But in the meantime, we do different things. And that's a problem. Okay, that's the model, because UN is just a meeting place. Samantha Power, in her book on Sergio Bill de Mello, quote a nice statement saying, blaming the UN Security Council for the lack of security in the world is like blaming the Madison Square Garden because the Knicks play bad basketball. Because it's a meeting place. It's not an institution itself. And that's the UN. But that's the best we can achieve. But what's happening in the meantime was at the national level, there was something.
I think Bruckner was the first time when I had to face people who was against me. The lead in my country was in favor of the military dictatorship, so I had to face my family.
The general Videla, in 96,
la velocidad
the same
la
guy, in 95,
son las dos notas del sistema de represión. Por eso hoy se hace necesario averiguar la verdad y juzgar a todos los que hayan violado la ley, en particular a los poderosos, a los máximos responsables.
And what happened was that was an incredible, after the end of the Cold War, was bam, 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 things happened that tribunals were created. And in addition, the Security Council has a consistent pattern defining any massive atrocity in, within the borders, start to reconsider it's a threat for peace and security in the world. So that was new. At the end of the Cold War, defined a new scenario. The Security Council was Security Council started with the gassing of the Kurds in Iraq, started to talk about this is affecting international peace and security, and in four cases they referred case to the International Criminal Court. But in addition, the Yugoslavia Tribunal was created, then the Rwanda, and then the Rome Treaty. So, moving from diplomacy to the implementation of the law. The problem is, we are living in literally two different standards. The blue countries adopted the law, international law, as a part of the internal system. And the white countries not. So, in fact, we have two different systems. These countries are like a confederation of states accepting the International Criminal Court. So it's like a confederation with no confederation government, no confederation congress, but with a court and prosecutors playing with them. And in these countries, they accept that the law will apply. And incredibly, it's working. A few weeks ago, the president of Kenya went to the ICC. Okay, maybe I had to make the story longer. Because how it's working? It's working in a way that's difficult to predict. In 2007, there was a very contested election in Kenya, and then the group who the government was re-elected. So the opposition party, one of the leaders, started to attack civilians who belong to the tribe and the party of the government, and displaced 400,000 people and killed more than 1,000. So members of the government start to attack the community of Mr. Ruto, who was the leader of the opposition, and they were killing each other. Then Kofi Annan went there, he negotiated an agreement, and they were all together in the government, and then we intervened to investigate the crimes. And we found that Minister, in those days was Deputy Prime Minister Kenyatta and Mr. Ruto were the leaders who were killing each other. And in some interesting impact of the court intervention, these two leaders who were killing each other made an agreement and presented a ticket in the presidential campaign. Imagine 1944, Churchill and Hitler making an agreement and proposing we create the European Union to end the wars, and we are a ticket, we are vice president and president together. Probably they will win, because people were fed up with wars, and then maybe you elect Hitler and Churchill playing together. And that was happening in Kenya. And they won elections, and they were elected. But interesting for me is the president of Kenya, 2 weeks ago, was summoned to the court, and he went to the court. And he for 2 days, he declined his own prerogatives and went to the SEC. And a journalist from the Council of Foreign Relations called me and saying, what do you think about this? You think it's sincere? And I said, I hope no. I hope it's not sincere. I hope what's happening here is a politician who understands what are his options. And his best option, because he needs legitimacy, national and international, he decided to go to the court. And that's why it's incredible, the power, the normative power is incredible. And it's showing here, okay? But in addition to that, you have this other standard, these countries, who are in the wild system. And here is no law, it's a lawless system. This is a Security Council can decide whatever they want, that's the law. When Russia veto the Syria referral to ICC, it's legal. Russia has the right to veto. And when the US is opposing to make any movement on Palestine, it's legal. They have the right to do it. So the legal system, the Security Council legal system, give a lot of space to discretion of the countries. That's why there are almost no rules there. However, they can refer cases to the ICC. So they did it in Darfur and in Libya. But basically, what's the problem today to understand the, it's a world in transition, it's a world changing. And then there's no, first, the only common value here is the idea no massive atrocities.
That's the only common value. Nothing else. Nothing else. It's important, but nothing else. Example of that. I went to Libya to Misrata. It's surrounded by the Gaddafi tanks. And they were very proud showing me a room like this full of pictures of the martyrs, the guys who were killed in the fight. And I told the guys, okay, very impressive, but I'm missing the girls. I'm missing the girls' rape. I understand you cannot present their pictures, but what are you doing with them? Because they could not be marginalized again. And he very proudly say, oh, no, no, we have a human rights program for them. Oh, amazing. How is that? And he said, the problem with the girl rape is that they lost their virginity. As a consequence, they cannot be married. And therefore, they are marginal forever. So, to manage the problem, we encourage people to marry them, even they are not virgins. And to show leadership, even I have two wives, I married two girls. So imagine. Exactly. You are a 15-year-old girl from Libya, raped, and your best option is to be the third wife or the fourth wife of this 45-year-old man. Should I say something? Should I say, oh no? No. In fact, when I mention this story, normally people say, oh my God, my Muslim friends understand better. They feel, okay. Yeah, because for them it's more normal to have four wives, and it's more normal to have a marriage arranged. So that's, in fact, it's a generous offer. But it's complicated, no? It's really, the cultural difference is huge. We see that. That's why the values are really few values. Basically, no massive atrocities, no massive rapes, no massive killings, but nothing else. And the other problem here, I believe, is in both systems, in this system or in the blue system, in both systems, there is no central authority. So we are building a global community with few common values and no central authority. And that is complicated. We feel, where is order here? Because order looks like a one value, okay, shared value with my community, and a central authority enforcing it. And maybe this global idea is impossible, I don't know. That's something, that for me is a real question. Is it possible to have a global community? Is it feasible? Because normally, communities are built with the idea of the enemy. So the enemy helped to create the community. And of course, except the Martians, they are no enemy of the global, except internal enemies. And that's why it's important. The global community help us to understand there are no enemies in the global community. They are criminals, but no enemies. So you cannot go to kill, you got to treat them with rights. But that is a complete new concept. It's not the normal thinking. The normal thinking is we live in a world of states with enemies and friends, and we build alliances and try to moderate the power, balancing power. And that's the theory, no? That's the current theory even today. Of course, the theory is complicated because what happened since September 11 is the enemy is no more a state. They are terror groups. And imagine, the idea of enemies and friends is complicated today. You just think in Iraq. Samantha Power book say that Saddam Hussein was receiving money to support his agricultural efforts. And he was supported because he was fighting Iran, and Iran was the enemy. And then there was information about Saddam Hussein was gassing the Kurds. And he was receiving $500 million. What happened the next year? Who guessed? What happened when the U.S. found Saddam Hussein was gassing the Kurds? What happened with this money, with these grants? They were double. He received $1 billion, again, instead of $500 million. However, after a few years, he was considered enemy, and you invade the country to throw up. And was appointed Mr. Maliki. But Maliki was creating a sectarian group, ISIS. So Maliki was a new friend, and Saddam Hussein became old friend, new enemy. Now Maliki was a new friend. But Maliki became stupid, creating more enemies, so it was removed. But now have the ISIS. And ISIS fighting Assad in Syria, who was the enemy. So, what to do?
Iran is our friend. Yeah.
Who? It's complicated. So, the idea, for me, the problem I see is the idea of friend and enemy requires states. But and it's not working very well even with Saddam Hussein. But without a state, it's easy. It's complicated, no? You are killing people in Pakistan, throwing drones. It's complicated. So all the new world, the threat are not just states. The threat are terrorist groups, organized crime. And the prevalent, the old idea of the 19th century are not working. But we are not adjusting. One of the problems was professors of international relations and social science and law, they are influenced by the economic method, and they like a quantitative analysis. And I have Stephen Craster, you know who is Stephen Craster?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know? No?
Yeah.
Well, you have to know. Yeah. Okay, Stephen Craster presented at Yale a beautiful paper showing how state work, what state were going up, state going down. And he got data from 1800. So he compared data from 1800 to 2000. Amazing. But I say, okay, it's amazing, but Facebook was started in 2003. Google became public in 2004. Everything changed. And what do you know about that? And he said, look, I know nothing. And I cannot talk about this issue because I have no data. So one of the problems I see the method, the quantitative method is not useful to measure things that are happening now. It's new. So we need a different approach. And that's something I expect you can do. Or you have to think. Because in particular, your generation had to invent a new world. Because my generation was destroying the past. My generation was thinking you had to destroy the old system. Your generation has a different, much complicated problem. You have to invent a new system. And I hope you can do it, because if not, it will be there. No, okay, because now I have more videos.
How much time?
No, I'd like to show example of a couple of things. I think it's a good example, the Gaddafi case.
This is how he emerged secure H27, brash and confident, who began to impose a pan-Arab anti-imperialist philosophy that won him friends and enemies. The people have gathered to express their revolution and say that they will not accept the camps and bases of colonialism on the Arab-Libyan people's soil. To the West, he was a bogeyman. He had links to Yasser Arafat. There were claims he funded FARC rebels in Colombia. He armed the IRA in Northern Ireland. And there was the shooting dead of a policewoman outside the Libyan embassy in London during an anti-Gaddafi protest. Ronald Reagan called him a mad dog, and in 1986 sent his jets to bomb Tripoli and Benghazi. It increased the rift between the West and Libya, but worse was to come. The 1988 Lockerbie bombing of Pan Am 103 marked the lowest point in relations between Libya and the West. Some claim Libya played no part, but Gaddafi was held responsible and sanctions were imposed, which crippled the country's economy. The invasion of Iraq brought a rethink in Tripoli and led to Gaddafi's rehabilitation in the global community. Quietly, behind the scenes, he admitted his country had a nuclear weapons program. When he agreed to international inspections, he got a frosty handshake from Tony Blair in a tent in the desert. Gaddafi was no longer considered dangerous. He was eccentric and became a colourful term at global gatherings. His oil meant he was accepted. He was regarded as a stabilising force, even if he did crush internal opposition and ran the country as the single power. In the end, he enjoyed a better relationship with the countries who once loathed him, the people he thought loved him.
power of Gaddafi. Gaddafi was had all the power in the world.
Libya deserves a permanent seat in the Security Council because of its great service to international peace and security.
Yeah, he was saying that.
So he took the ceremonial gavel and will be the chair of the African Union for the next year.
Chairperson of the African Union, chairperson, the leader of the Security Council, and General Assembly.
Distinguished members of the General Assembly of the United Nations, in the name of the African Union, I would like to welcome you. I do call that this gathering will be a historic one in the world and the history of the world. And in the name of the General Assembly that is presided by Libya now, in the name of the African Union.
And suddenly everything changed.
A systematic murder by his regime of its own people. It happened in the city British forces are now trying to protect. We've evidence of Gaddafi's men firing at unarmed protesters.
Come into your city. We will ask you to show no mercy for the traitors. We are going to hunt them down wherever they are. We're going to track them down one by one.
I can tell you today there is a big massacre. While the people were marching to the cemetery, bearing 30 martyrs on their way, they were hit with live ammunition in front of the army brigade in Birka. And 4 demonstrators were killed. There's a big massacre happening. We hear every few minutes that there are people killed.
Okay. Let me wait for a second, because for me, this story of Gaddafi is a great story. Poor guy did not understand how the world changed it. Because imagine, he was bombing airplanes in Scotland, shooting policewomen in London, promoting terrorists around the world. In Libya, he goes, in Libya it was illegal to criticize Gaddafi. That was for him, all these demonstrators were criminal. Because according with the Libyan law, they were criminal. And also, he made a deal with Blair on oil and with Blair and US on helping against fundamentalism, because Gaddafi was not Islamist. So the Islamic people were against Gaddafi. So Gaddafi decided, when he saw what happened in Iraq, he changed sides. And he became, as they say, member of the international community. In 2009, you saw this picture of Gaddafi going to Berlusconi. This was a G8 meeting. Gaddafi used this meeting to request to end Switzerland. Switzerland had to be divided in 3 parts, going back to France, Germany, and Italy. Why? Because his son was in Switzerland, arrested for one day because he was hitting the waiter in the hotel. And in retaliation, Gaddafi arrested two Swiss businessmen in Tripoli. And after he said that Switzerland should be dismantled, the poor president of Switzerland went to Tripoli to see how to deal the problem, finish with the problem, humiliated. They make a deal. He went back. He recognized Switzerland was wrong, will pay compensation, blah, blah. And then the two Swiss personality to be released, they were moved to a secret detention place. So Switzerland had no idea what to do, because between war and nothing between war and frustration. So Switzerland decided to ban Gaddafi and other members of the government to go to Switzerland. But because Switzerland is part of the Schengen Agreement, the banning of Switzerland banned them in all Europe. So suddenly Libyans cannot go to Europe. So Gaddafi retaliate and ban all Europeans coming to Tripoli. So what happened? Big deal with the European Union. What the European Union did? Back in Switzerland or back in Gaddafi? Who guessed?
Gaddafi,
of course. European Union forced Switzerland to end the ban and apologize to Gaddafi. So that's the context. For Gaddafi, shooting the civilians in the street were nothing. He was a friend now, helping to fight Al-Qaeda. How can be against him? It's really unpredictable for him. He's a victim of this unpredictable, because suddenly what happened here, see what happened.
Resolution 1970 includes an arms embargo, asset freeze, and travel bans for longtime Libyan leader Muammar Gaddafi and his associates. It also refers Gaddafi to the International Criminal Court for alleged crimes against humanity.
For the first time ever, the Security Council has unanimously referred an egregious human rights situation to the International Criminal Court.
Okay, that's for me important, because that was the only moment in my 9 years at The Hague, where I saw 2 weeks the world united and required very strange situation. Nothing about ideology. It's about a specific movement. First, Gaddafi was hated. Many countries hate Gaddafi. That's important. Second, Sarkozy made a big disaster in Tunisia. Sarkozy has a lot of interest, France has a lot of interest in the Mediterranean, and Sarkozy was promoting the Union Mediterranean. So when Tunisia Arab Spring started, Sarkozy, Minister of Foreign Affairs, offered publicly the Gendarmerie to Ben Ali. And Ben Ali escaped 2 days later, request asylum in Saudi Arabia. So it was embarrassing for them. So Sarkozy saw this as an opportunity to go back, to be on top of the Arab world. So he decided to be again Gaddafi. Even Gaddafi say, I gave money, I gave 7 million to him to for his campaign. But in any case, Sarkozy did it. And Qatar, because Egypt was in troubles, imagine, 2011, everything changed. In Egypt, Mubarak was thrown out. So, and Qatar took a lead in the Arab League. So Qatar was pushing the Arab League to request a change. And also individuals are very important. For this, what you saw, the resolution Security Council, was critically important. The deputy ambassador, not the ambassador you saw, the deputy ambassador of Libya, he did the following. On Friday started the crimes. On Monday morning, he called the member of the embassy and said, I'm fed up. I will not work for Gaddafi again. This afternoon, I will announce I will be with the people. You can choose to be with me or not to come with me because it's dangerous. Everyone, the 13 persons say, no, we are with you. Okay, so you'll be with me, behind me, in the press conference. And they asked, what about the ambassador? Because the ambassador that you saw talking was very close to Gaddafi. And they said, what about ambassador? Let me talk to him, I will manage. He will not be part of that, but it's okay, we'll not fight with him. So it's the wisdom of the Arab people. Half hour before the press conference, the deputy ambassador called the ambassador and said, Ambassador, I'm going to give a press conference announcing I will be with the people, with the rebellion. Do you have instruction for me? And the ambassador say, do whatever you want, and you'd like to join me. No. So basically he did it, but without fighting the ambassador. In some way the ambassador knew that he was going to do it. So he went to the press conference, he requests ICE intervention, he requests Security Council intervention, and make a big deal. And was the first big defection. After him, everyone was defecting. But he knew Security Council changed their mind each 2 days. Who remembered today what happened in Gaza a few months ago? No one. The international relations is moving fast. He knew that. So he was thinking, we need to move this week. But he cannot call for a Security Council meeting because he was the deputy ambassador. So what he did, that's why knowing the rules is also important. It's the political factors, lucky factors, and technical factors combined. He knew the rules, so he sent a note verbal informing the Ban Ki-moon that the ambassador was not going to the mission, so the deputy ambassador was representing Libya now. And then he signed a note, signing by himself, requesting a Security Council meeting. And then he got it. And then Sarkozy came on board, Qatar, and then they moved. And then China, okay, it's longer, but just to show you, it's not about theory. This just happened. It's a combination of factors. People requesting no violence against others, political changes, and then individuals taking the lead, and suddenly, boom, a huge change, a very unusual fact. That's happened. And I knew that because I fooled there. What I did, you see, I ran. You see now? Immediately we start to open investigations and move.
Today, 3rd of March 2011, the Office of the Prosecutor decided to open an investigation into alleged crimes against humanity committed in Libya since 15th of February. I am honored to report to this Council on the Office of the Prosecutor activities in furtherance of Resolution 1970. I will request the judges to issue arrest warrants against three individuals who appear to bear the greatest criminal responsibility for crimes against humanity committed in the territory of Libya since 15 February 2011.
So I announced to the Security Council what they will do, trying to
based
keep them
on the evidence collected. The prosecution has applied to Pretrial Chamber 1 for the issuance of arrest warrants against Muammar Mohammed Abu Minyar Gaddafi, Saif al-Islam Gaddafi, and Abdullah al-Sanusi. The judges will decide.
The chamber hereby issues 1. A warrant of arrest for Muammar Mohammed Abu Minyar Gaddafi. 2. A warrant of arrest for Saif al-Islam Gaddafi. 3. A warrant of arrest for Abdullah al-Senussi.
The Office of the Prosecutor will conduct further investigations. First, allegation of rapes. Second, allegation of killings of sub-Saharan Africans considered mercenaries. And third, war crimes.
We will announce to the world. We announce to the world that Muammar Gaddafi has been killed. On the hands of the revolutionaries.
وطويت إلى غير رجعة صفحة القذافي ونظامه واستبداده عن ليبيا وعن وجه الأرض.
And Gaddafi's tyranny and dictatorship has been finally ended, and this chapter has been closed for Libya and for all the world.
Gaddafi's son Saif al-Islam once vowed to fight and die on Libyan soil. Reuters has learned that he has proposed surrendering to the International Criminal Court in The Hague, where he is wanted for war crimes.
Okay, that was just a flavor of interaction, injustice, and political actors, but my story shows how nothing is, there's no protocol, it's just happening. And let me finish. So, in some way, the world is progressing.
And to show that, I like the connection between Nuremberg and the ICC. You remember this guy? He was a 26-year-old prosecutor, now old. I appoint him a special counsel. He was the first trial at the ICC.
Mr. Friends?
May it please your honors. This is a historic moment. I am now in my 92nd year. Having spent a lifetime striving for a more humane world governed by the rule of law, I am honored to represent the prosecutor regarding the significance of this trial. In Rome, over 100 sovereign states decided that child recruitment were, and I'm quoting now from the statute, among the most serious crimes of concern for the international community as a whole. Vengeance begets vengeance. Seizing and training young people to hate and kill undermines the legal and moral firmament of human society. Let the voice and the verdict of this esteemed global court now speak for the awakened conscience of the world.
Okay. That is my name. Because my point today was, okay, in some way there is an evolution. The world is progressing. ICC now is stable. We have a global legal system that was absolutely unpredictable just 20 years ago. And it's working. But there's not yet order. Because there are conflicting protocols between people who expect should not be genocide, prosecutors and judges who believe they have to follow the rule, the law, and political people who are following a different protocol. They are doing negotiations. They are not relying on law. For them, it is strange, this idea of the law. I remember when I started my tenure, asking my international issue advisor, we are trying to open a case in Congo, how to do it? And she said, what you should do normally in diplomatic scenarios is you go, you explain to 5 or 6 diplomats who can be in principle friendly with you. If they agree, then when you present the idea, the 6 of them support you. And when 6 support, the others are coming, no one will oppose. That is the way to work. And I say, but what happened if the diplomats oppose the idea? Oh, then you cannot do it. But we are prosecutors. We cannot submit our criterion to the diplomats. I said, but you're taking a big risk. So the policy we adopted was, as you saw in the Libya case, we announced in advance what we will do, thinking that will help the politicians to adjust. It's not. When I did Bashir, in December 2007 and June 2008, I announced my next case will be the person who gave instructions to the minister who was indicted. I cannot mention the name because it's a Security Council, the names are for the judges, but I did it. And then in July, I request arrest warrant for Bashir. In September, I came to New York, and I have a meeting with an ambassador who tell me, how you can indict the head of state without telling us in advance? I said, what do you mean, ambassador? I say it twice. December 2007, June 2008, I say that. And he say, you say that, but we did not believe you would do it. But because it's a different protocol. For them, you just move when they agree with you. If not, you cannot move. And this simple example is for me the biggest problem we have today. Because for lawyers, we cannot just let the diplomat to decide what we should do. We are not prosecutors if we do that. But for diplomats, two different groups. They cannot. And the lack of interaction is creating the disorder. We are not efficient. We are not using the best tool we have, and therefore everyone feels the world is chaos. And that is for me the challenge. How we can increase understanding between different groups. That is for me the question I give to you. I hope you can provide the answer.
Thank you so much. I'm
have a lot of questions, I'm sure people here have a lot of questions.
Yeah, let me get to your question, so please.
Yes.
The idea is to have a conversation with you now. Those international relations people, you fight international relations. What do you think about this, what I say? Is someone teaching to you about this evolution, these judges and lawyers and legal frameworks or not? Is in your curricula something about this or not? It's a simple question, right? What's happening?
Well, if you are taking my class now,
I have answered,
yes, Frederick,
that teaches it to us, yes.
Ah, he
class. No, but I think that's a balance. I think that we're taught the concrete what you can understand, but it's for us as, like you said, as we evolve to try to understand the evolution, where we fit into it and what the next step is, so that we're ready for it, if that makes sense.
Okay. So you have to understand better. Me too. Okay. Can you explain the game? What you, if in addition to him, anyone is teaching you about international courts and this kind of material in your classes or international relations or not? No. That means no. You cannot remember.
Personally, I've been to the ICC. I've been to the
you were there.
Tribune in
Rwanda. Why?
And Yugoslavia.
Why you did that?
Personal research.
Wow.
Also, like, it's being that, like, I'm from Cuba personally, like, it was very important for me that you guys tried to go on my boat. But the way that it's presented to us, at least in the media, I don't have access to it.
And what about you in your school? You're here, no? In the International Relations School.
I'm a sophomore in the Global Studies Bachelor's.
Okay. And what's happening with Global Studies?
Yeah, I've taken a few international law courses, and I feel like we touch upon the surface of it. In my other international relations classes, I feel like not as much. But I've been introduced to these subjects.
So, you feel the gap? You feel there's a gap between international law studies and the international relations studies?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. How can I think that? Is this a way to approach that gap? Because that is for me the biggest problem. We have this, and this specialization is killing the knowledge, basically. How can connect? Yes.
Isn't it utopian to think that some countries will heed their self-interest more than these international commitments?
But what is self-interest? Self-interest was supporting Saddam Hussein for self-interest? No, it was not a good idea to support Saddam Hussein. So basically, if you make a historical study, you see what you look like a good idea in the short term is a very bad idea in the long term. U.S. supported Saddam Hussein, Bin Laden, Gaddafi, Noriega invading Panama. So invading many countries where they were friends before. So this idea is not working very well. I'm not saying we have to ignore it, but it has problems. It's not utopia. What is utopia is build order on this basis.
How do you convince people of that?
No, for me, what I see is this ICC, no one is supporting now. There's zero leader. If no political leader supporting it, I remember Zuma, the president of South Africa, organized a reception, and he was receiving us when we arrived, and said, "Oh, president, you're my president, you're the big champion of the ICC. Please don't say that. So, there is no political leadership. However, it's still moving. It's still, because the people support the idea, and for politicians, it's difficult to oppose people. That's why, I don't know what is happening, but it's happening, it's something happening here. And utopias ignore that. What is naive is ignore that. What is naive is believe power is just about weapons. No. In the world today, power is about massive number of people believe in the same idea. That's power. That's why for me, I need is from you, build some electronic tool to disseminate this idea massively, because that's what we need. What's the name of Tanislav, your Greek guy who's working with you in the Greek case?
Kalibas.
Andreas Kalibas. He was teaching at Yale.
That's a brother.
Ah, that's a brother.
Yeah.
What's the name of the brother?
Stati.
Okay. So, he was teaching about the impact of peaceful demonstration. And the bottom line was, when the peaceful demonstrations were massive, huge impact. When there no massivity, no impact. So I asked him, what happened with violent demonstrations? Well, when they are massive, huge impact. When they are no massive, no impact. So it's about massivity. The new world is about massivity. That, for me, it's strange. It's not about if your idea is right or wrong. It's about how many believe in your idea. Because then, if there are many, politicians will follow. Yeah.
I think that the ICC was, of course, a huge accomplishment. But I'd like to know from you, would it be also effective if we could spread the system of human rights protection? And I'll mention just one case, the Pinochet case, where you have like a Spanish judge referring to a British court to arrest a Chilean dictator. So, of course, it's good that we have a centralized court, but wouldn't it be also effective to have like a more spread out system of enforcing this rules?
Okay, what is happening is it's closing down. The university jurisdiction is closing down because judges from Belgium and Spain are trying, or France are trying to prosecute Rumsfeld and Kissinger, closing down.
Chinese leaders,
so it's closing down. I believe the university jurisdiction has a problem because there is no legitimacy for these judges elected in one country to be involved in a different country. We were elected by 120 delegates, so it's a different legitimacy. I believe it's a legitimacy problem. But the torture convention established university jurisdiction. But it's difficult to move.
Can I just add one thing about legitimacy? Because you mentioned yesterday Colombia. And on the one hand, you have this elected government trying to deal with the former guerrillas to end...
current guerrillas.
Yeah, current guerrillas.
4,000.
Right, who have been struggling for, six decades?
Five
decades. More than five. And then the current prosecutor at the ICC releases this letter that was called by Colombian newspapers a bomb letter, saying that if they don't...
You know what he's talking about? You know?
Yeah. Okay. If you don't prosecute properly those guys, the ICC will intervene somehow and this won't be valid before the international law. I mean, if you don't want to answer, of course I'd like to know your position about that, but if it's...
The prosecutor is great. She's the best prosecutor.
Do you think that the ICC has legitimacy to address, like, at this level, I mean, elected government, they are discussing that at the Colombian Supreme Court. I mean, just to put another case. If you were the current prosecutor and you had a case like South Africa, where the
extreme... Keep the Colombian. This morning I had two interviews on this topic, so I'm very well prepared.
I mean, would you agree to interfere in this?
No, that's not the point. Look, the prosecutor can decide at the end of the process to intervene or intervene. So I think it's very nice from her to inform in advance what she would do, because it's letting the Colombians to take into consideration. And the Colombians are managing risk. They have to define what to do. But now, at least they know that if there is no jail or real punishment to the leaders, the prosecutor will try to open a case. But they know they can challenge the prosecutor's decision before the judges. And they have the pretrial chamber and the appeal chamber. So it's a process they can follow. And now Colombia can make a decision how to do it. They will decide. Because what is the prosecutor has the ability to do it at the end of the process. Well, she was very nice and candid and supportive, is informing them in advance what she will do. She's not imposing them.
She's doing politics.
No, she's telling them, be careful, I consider that this policy will be illegal. I will do something. And they can, now they take into consideration that. In any case, that for me is showing the new world we're living, where suddenly the Colombia peace process is amazing because it's including the victims, and we'll end with a referendum. So it's an incredible process, highly complicated, with the prosecutor also jumping on it. It's an incredible experience. We'll see how it's ended. And I think it's showing the new world in which we're living, which is highly complicated. And imagine, I know, the poor president of the Colombia has managed so many variables. And there's no academia here helping him. You are not helping him. You are not providing a clear framework, okay, this is the way to do it, guys. No, you're not talking about this issue. Yes?
I have a question about another model that recently happened in Guatemala, with the national trial of the former dictator, Efraín Ríos Montt. I'm curious your opinion about, given that we have the ICC, is it a step backwards to try him?
No, the contrary. Court? ICC...
How do you feel about that case?
No, ICC... First, the case is before ICC. It's not for ICC, but in my swimming, I say the best outcome of this court would be zero case. Because ICC...
So Guatemala takes care of it.
Obvious, because the law say primacy for the national system. And ICC,
Sorry, go on.
No.
And then once he's convicted and then the sentence is turned over on procedural grounds, at what point does it become clear that Guatemala stops having...
Okay, but the Guatemala case is before 2002. Right. So the court cannot intervene with the matter.
They can't.
No, the court intervened just in crimes committed after 2002.
Okay, so this is a theoretical question then. Like, what do you think of it if the ICC doesn't control the areas of the world that you call the Wild West, right? The non-signatories of the United States.
Ah, we do nothing. ICC
what has option? So they have to rely on the national model. So they are back in the 20th century, if not the 19th century.
Yes.
Is that the...
We are living in two different worlds. Mm-hmm. The blue countries are more institutionally evolved and the white countries are not.
Another question.
And the court can do nothing because it's like asking the American prosecutor why you are not intervening in Germany.
What do you think would have to happen in order for the Wild West countries to behave themselves and become blue countries? Or is that totally outside of the realm of possibility?
Oh, it's a matter of time. 50 years, probably everyone would be blue, or maybe...
I think so.
Look, where I started, 2003, there were 78. Mm. When I finished, 122. In just 9 years. So we'll see. I think it's a matter of evolution. Yeah.
In particular, how likely do you think that a country like the U.S. would agree to? I feel like that might be one of the more difficult countries to get to sign it, or Russia or China.
No, but it's... Big countries have big armies. They don't need the law to be protected. Small countries have no army or small armies, then they need the law to be protected. So that is the rationale.
But you also have the victory security council. So for example, let's say, hypothetically, if China decides to ratify the treaty and enter into a new territory, they still have the veto in the security council to...
To what? If they are blue, the veto is nothing.
Yeah.
For a different, but not for a...
If they are blue, any kind, okay, and the prosecutor could open any investigation.
They can veto a referral.
Yes, but they cannot interfere when they are blue. They are blue, the security council has nothing to do. That way, the security council is a different model. It's a wild model, where few, it's an imperial model, where few countries are running the world. And José Álvarez used this category, empire of the law or law of the empire. So the blue countries are under the empire of the law. And the white countries are under the law of the empire. The security country is a collective empire. And that is the system today. That's why, it's funny, when I took office, we were thinking connecting with the security country would be great. In fact, what's happening is that Libya and their full case created a lot of controversies. Because they say, why you send Libya or Darfur and not Palestine and other? Because security countries got this problem. There are no rules there. There are some rules, but basically each country can do whatever they want. Yes?
So I think about something you said about the difference between enemies and criminals.
Right? Okay, that's crucial.
That now we can speak of groups that, or individuals that can be treated as criminals, that should be treated as criminals.
Yes.
They should be put under a legal framework. Think about the discourse surrounding ISIS,
yes,
which is both. It's,
yes.
They are enemies of civilization. They are exactly the opposite of civilization.
They're committing genocide.
And they are committing genocide and crimes. But then what's the treatment?
Okay.
They are both. They're
yeah.
Being framed as being
where are they? Are they operating in the blue countries or in the white countries? They are in the white countries, so they are. It's complicated. But all the contrary, look, I saw many Ba'athist criminals in my life. All of them are justifying themselves with the idea they were protecting their own community and attacking the enemies. So the justification for massive criminality is about, it's not, massive criminals are talking about the good intention they have. The good intention is about protecting their own people. When I investigated Videla, my mother was against me. My mother was thinking Videla was protecting her. When Milosevic died, 50,000 people went to the cemetery to give a recognition. When Mladic appeared before the SDY, he said, I am in front of this satanic court because I was protecting my people. The Hutus were saying that. The Hutus were protecting the Hutus against the Tutsis. It's always the ISIS is protecting the Muslim against the infidels. Always the same. It's about protecting my community against the other. So the only way to have no massive atrocity is to have a global community. So all of you, and then we protect you to the law. Hiroshima said that. In Hiroshima they developed the concept, I don't remember the word in Japanese, saying to protect Hiroshima, you need to protect that no city in the world receive a nuclear bomb. And it's true that the only way to protect your city to receive a nuclear bomb is to protect all the cities in the world. There's no way to have a dome or just protecting your city. And that's the new concept we have to develop, moving beyond tribal. Because in fact, moving beyond tribal is to a civilization. But the move is just a scale. In particular, for my generation, it's complicated. Maybe for your generation, it's different.
I mean, but my point is precisely that these are the enemies of civilization. There's no, I mean, this is how they're framed. There's no...
Okay, but
the argument is there's no legal treatment for these people.
Okay, that is the people who are thinking the old way. Yeah.
But well, these are the guys with the military power. That's kind of the concern for the...
But that's the problem. There are two different ways to see the problem. One is the idea of the law, right. The other is the idea of just kill my enemy. And those who want to kill the enemy, they are the pragmatic guys.
But you just said a couple of minutes ago that your problem in order to create a global community was how to think of the enemy. That it's needed to create an enemy.
No, that's why. I say normally community will create around the enemy idea.
Well, but that's you are.
And that's why we need now to. That's why it's complicated. That's why I present to you the problem.
But that's also, you're also working on a Schmittian concept that you can't get rid of it. Yeah. I mean, Schmitt create this enemy friend relationship in order to talk about how the international relations work and also even how to talk about internal states work. And you can go beyond that, creating concatenation for equal demands in order to create a people without an enemy. And I think that's possible. However, the problem is that you need a foundational moment that needs a constitution. And the United Nations does not resolve that. The ICC does not address that. That's not the work that it has to do, actually.
You need a constitution, you mean a legal text?
If you want to create a global community or a global federation or state.
Okay, the global federation is created, guys. ICC is the global federation.
But it was not created by the people. It was just ratified by states, representative states, not the people within the states.
And you like a popular vote in the world.
No, but what I'm saying is like you ask students...
State decision is the closest we have.
Yeah, but it creates problems. You ask
you are trying to export not just the sense of community to the world. You are also trying to export the tools we use at the national level. And I believe maybe we don't need the same tool. We can accept other tools.
But then, yes, but then we need another kind of arranging a political community that goes beyond the state. But that means...
No, I would suggest include the state, but not the only. In the same way, in the federal, in the U.S., you have a state, Texas and Massachusetts, but then the federal system.
Yes.
And the Supreme Court defined what is state, what is federal. Probably we need a separate layer. What is national and what is global?
Okay, but it needs, I mean,
and that is a way to put a new layer in the current layer. You have the cities, the states, the national system, and the global system. At the global, it's just a few things, massive atrocities, marrying girls, raping. I'm sorry.
No, I understand that, but you asked before, how do we study the International Criminal Court? And for example, at the New School for Social Research, I mean, I was a lawyer, I studied political science, and now I'm doing a PhD in sociology, and the way that we are studying in anthropology, sociology classes, the human rights, the international human rights covenants, is that they actually are not legitimate democratically and have other problems. Like, you probably know Mahmoud Mandani's criticism of the ICC very well. But it is, I mean, there is something about it. I mean, you say this is the empire of law or the law of empires, but Sudan, who's not part of the ICC, you were able, just because of the Security Council, to actually indict Bashir as a head of state of Sudan, as committing crimes against humanity. So it's not that there's this border that we cannot cross.
No, because Sudan's peace is part of the UN Charter. And the UN Charter authorized the Security Council to decide that.
The problem is that probably no one is going to indict or try to indict Bush, well, 2003, Bush or anyone because of the war of Iraq. Also, and you have the crime of aggression in the ICC Charter, for example.
That's true. Probably it would be difficult to, but it's normally also in the national system. The law is not easy to apply the law against powerful people. That's
I agree.
Normal. That's a normal problem.
I agree. I mean, in that we have complete agreement.
Okay,
no, I'm just...
So, yes, it would be more complicated to indict people with a lot of power. Yes, I agree with you. That's why I normally was involved in cases against people powerful people.
No,
I like
know,
that. It's fun. But it's complicated.
No.
It's highly complicated. Yeah. Power is about... Yeah, people with power, they like to use power. You know, it's a great cartoon in the New Yorker. Two members of the Congress, leaving the Congress here in the U.S., one turning to the other. What I cannot understand is this issue of abuse of power. Because if you got power and you cannot abuse of it, why do you need power?
It's a different conception of power, I mean.
Yeah. Okay, so my point is, power will be always a problem, but what is happening now, and that is it is showing, Gaddafi was thrown out. So power is changing. It's not just in stone. Power is changing. Nixon was indicted. Videla ended in jail, afterwards pardoned. So it's always not linear. What I see, sometimes the idealists are really idealists. They like rosy, everything rosy, nothing black, and they don't care about reality. And that's, for me, is a problematic.
Because it's gray.
Eh?
Because reality is gray.
Yes, I always say I had to put in place a project that was an agreement between dreamers and hypocritical people. They made an agreement, and they gave me, okay, now implement it. Of course, everyone shoot me, because they were not thinking operations. Look, the first time I'm talking about this, so many, I'm sure many of the professors of human rights will find all the problems in different areas. I understand, and I could agree with some of them. I don't agree with the idea you have to export all the national systems to the global system. I don't think we need popular vote, because in many countries there are no popular vote. Qatar, many countries have no popular vote. And the Congress, I think, is complicated, because the Congress was created when there was nothing, even, I don't know, the telegraph was existing. The representation required ignorance of those who are represented. So that's why the problem is the world is changing and we are not adjusting. But this is incredible. That this happening is totally incredible. And then we need to learn from that. And how to make more efficient. Not if this is in accordance with our ideal world.
But now, would you say that it would be, integral from different kinds of societies, I mean, to ratify the treaty and become signatory? I mean, because in terms of politicians making these decisions, it would be problematic for them to now have this other layer, as the Colombian very complex case showed. So why they would join this, I mean, the treaty? Because of...
I think the treaty was created in a moment very peculiar. Was the end of the Cold War, was the end of apartheid, Europe in the Balkans, so it was a momentum. But now, what is interesting is resilient. The treaty is really resilient. No one is leaving. And so it's moving, because basically the treaty represents an idea of the society, and it's working. So in some way, I don't know why exactly, but it's happening. In the same way, sometimes inertia is against change. Here, now inertia is in favor of change. And we keep moving. We not disappear. What I know, I still will not disappear now. How to do more efficient use of the SEC? That's for me. And it's not about having everyone in blue. It's be more efficient. I mean, more efficient, it means integrate better the legal tools, the military actions, and diplomatic actions. And no one is watching that. Everyone is, professors are have a silo view. Yes?
You started up with a kind of jurisprudential antinomy, right? The IR position, and then I think the simplistic human rights position. I mean, the IR position that states are in the state of nature, something like that.
Yeah.
The simplistic human rights position is that once you have statutes or norms,
applied,
the world is under law. And what I think, in a way, you're doing is splitting the difference between them. That is, in other words, you have not come up with a new jurisprudential model. What you've done is actually say half the world is one way and the other half of the world is the other way. Now, I think actually that both perspectives in this antinomy are not well formulated. And I think in the case of the legal part, which is your side, and I think the idea that just because you have norms, you have law, confuses normative structures and law. Normative structures can take other forms. Morality, for example, they're norms. In a way, they are asking for too much. On the other side, the international affairs people are actually asking for too little, because it's an absurd idea that just because there's no enforcement, these norms don't matter. I mean, a lot of your examples, Gaddafi, you know, you guys didn't get him. A revolution got him. The revolution is the same norm. So in a way, both positions aren't right. So I think the picture is better than what you present, but it's also worse. It's better from the point of view of the international affairs realists, because the world isn't like that. It's not state of nature, and actually, hasn't been like that in the times Hobbes cooked this up. On the other side, the position is too optimistic, because in fact, even in the blue part, for example, I think he's right. If the Security Council chooses to defend a member on the blue part, you still have a problem.
No.
But maybe you can wrong about that.
Yeah, in this part you're wrong, but I like your comment. What I'm trying to write now, and I like very much your comment, is a mistake is to believe the law is what is in the paper.
Right, it's always a mistake.
The law, yes, yeah. We need the law in the paper and the process, but then we need to learn how the actors apply the law. And that's what I'm trying to write. I'm trying to explain what is the rationale of my decisions, but also explain the reaction of the other actors, how they reacted. And so, in some way, José Álvarez say, the modern study of law include not just the law in the paper, include how the members of the executive and the judges and the members of the Congress implement the law.
And of course the legal profession,
yes, and the
pressures for it.
Yes, and the actors, yes, exactly. Social movement, exactly. Exactly, each actor, yes. Right. The integration of all these individuals implementing the norms or ignoring the norms, or what I tend to present, in fact, is in the same way as a prosecutor I was trying to implement the norms, the legal norms, I saw the diplomats trying to implement their own rules, their own protocols, which are different than mine.
But they're not free of your norms either.
No, but more or less. Because, look, I remember the young diplomats at The Hague invited me for a meeting. And I did an exercise with them, presenting the CONI problem, and say some people believe I should stop my investigation on CONI, some people believe I should go ahead. What do you think about it? Well, 50 guys. I said, who believe I should stop to allow the peace negotiation? 3 right there. Okay. Who believe I should stay? 5 right there. Normally it was much more active discussion when I used this example. And this guy were not talking. And then I said, look, I believe the problem is so complicated that you cannot make an opinion on that. And the guy gave me a great lecture. No, Prosecutor, it's a different interpretation. Because your question was, what do you think about this? And we are diplomats. We don't think. We receive instructions. And on this topic, we have no instruction. And in some way, he was describing his protocol. He will apply the law in the way the minister or the ambassador or someone higher in the hierarchy define the law. And he will do that. And additionally, the treaty is requesting the states to cooperate with judiciary and to finance, but not to put political support. Political support is not there. And this is a discretion of them. That's why I spent the Sarkozy idea. Why Sarkozy decided to go against Gaddafi? Was for his own vision. That's why it's complicated. To understand the rules, you have to understand how different actors, the norms that different actors are following. And that could create a really...
He has newspapers in France. He has pressure groups in France. I mean, he has to face opinion. So yeah. He's not just deciding on the basis of nothing. The norm plays a role even in his decision.
Yeah.
He has a primary.
My point was exactly that. That different, there are different norms, not just the legal norms. And there are different norms guiding the behavior of people. And we have to understand that if we have to create order. That is my entire point. I'm following your idea, and maybe I have to present better. But my entire point is, to understand how the world works, we have to understand the transform. It's not that the diplomats are bad guys, just they have different norms. And if we like a different outcome from them, we have to work on their norms. That's the concept, yes.
I guess I'm curious, because you definitely are presenting, you know, international law as, you know, a process that is evolving and moving forward, seemingly. But looking at, you know, kind of the trend, there does seem to be a necessity of genocide to push it forward in a weird way. Like, you know, I mean, we have the Holocaust when you get Nuremberg, you have Yugoslavia and Rwanda, and that kind of rekindles things. So I guess the question is sort of twofold. Like, one, how can that progression continue in a sort of non-reaction-based way? Like, what can we do? Because obviously, like, you know, that makes sense in some regards, but when you're talking about thousands or millions of people dying, you know, reaction is not the way you generally want to fight back against that. And secondly, like, you know, building on that, like, what's to ensure that you know, progression, like, you seem very confident, and I mean, I obviously hope you're right, but that progression is going to continue in kind of like a way that is, you know, each thing is building on the other and there's kind of, you know, materialistic way in which it moves forward. What's to stop it, you know, from moving in the opposite direction and, like, you know, especially with it being so reaction-based? And how do we overcome that?
You're convincing me I need to do a really strong introspective effort to change my optimism and not to... I'm passionate about what I'm discussing. I'm not sure
I hope you're right.
No. I'm not optimist. I don't know what will happen. I have to be much more uncertain. I don't know what will happen. And in fact, when you see the big... professors are not defining the world. Our theories are not defining the world. Actors... It's interesting because... In Argentina or in Nuremberg, what happened was a political momentum, some leadership. In the world was Roosevelt and Churchill. In Argentina was President Alfonsín voted for people. And they created a political request. And there they were technical people who could implement the trials or the technical solutions. And that worked. And it's just generated a moment. But then the Cold War came and then the moment appear, but then the Cold War end and the moment appear again. So that is the process I see. I don't see, and the world is reactive, always reactive. No one is just defining the future. You need the pressure of the people and leaders driving. on the past, that was in the past. I'm not sure in the future the leader will drive. Probably the leader will follow. And that's why I believe we need massive number of citizens thinking in some way, then the leader will follow. So I'm not very optimistic. I think the world could be a mess, could be a disaster. And we are ready to disappear as a humanity. And that's why maybe I had to be more catastrophic to present the problem better, because my generation will not fix the problem. We cannot even talk between us. Stephen Graffin, the guy I was mentioning, is for me the genius in international relations. When we discussed, he said, read the problem, I don't understand the law. I said, Tib, I like that you're so candid, but it's a problem. You cannot be proud of that. But he had no problem, because for him the law is not part of his discipline. So, and he's the best, probably. And that's the problem. Steven Pinker wrote this book about the better nature of our angels. In one paragraph he mentioned that one of the reasons that there are less violence is because institutional. And he mentioned SEC as a new global development. And he made fun of the international relations professors, saying a group self-appointed realists believe institutions are not existing, he said. And he criticized them. And then I went to the Pink and said, are you planning to talk on this issue? Oh no, Luis, I wrote my book. I did it. So he moved. And of course, in international relations people, they don't care if Steven Pinker is thinking they are crazy or stupid. They don't care. They just keep the move. And if you're a young professor, you just need to convince the older professor that they are right. That's why what I see is we are not producing knowledge about what's happening today. And I like your comment, because I think I should be more precise how to present this more catastrophically and more about the nuance, how the norms are created by different actors. That is the real game. And that's why I was thinking historians can present this properly. You can take just what happened today in Syria, explain as historians, not as theorists. I don't know. My feeling is we need to do something different. And that's my goal. Yeah.
Going back to Emmanuel, what you said before, and the ethical question in a sense.
Could you speak louder, please?
Going back to the ethical question, and speaking as an historian student, or a history student, we have to readdress in a sense the question of national self-determination and sovereignty, which is the nation state is a contingent historical entity. It's not even 200 years old. In a sense, and the UN paradoxically is a representation of these states. So kind of, without relegating in a hierarchy of the ethical hierarchy, actually relegating the right of self-determination below human rights in some kind of canonical text, I don't see how we can actually transcend from these white countries from mass atrocities to more developed ideas of human rights and stuff. Take even Saudi Arabia and whole debate about them decapitating more people than ISIS ever did every year, right? But that is their right as a sovereign self-determination. They can just, as you said, they can just say, oh, well, female circumcision is what we do in our culture, and that is our right as a sovereign country. Until the UN does not have some kind of charter, it will, in a sense, a text that deals or determines what is actually a human, healthy human condition, in a sense. I don't think you can get anyone in or out, in a sense, right? The UN will still be just terminal and not a real entity.
But that's why I believe the ICC treaty, it was an advance for civilization, because it is a proposal that sovereignty is not authorizing to commit massive atrocities. That's it. And then the state took the sovereign decision to implement a global system to control, even within the territory of the state, massive atrocities. That's why it's not about human rights. It's a one single value, no massive atrocities. And there's a rationale for that, because massive atrocities normally cross the border. And they're not just national. When you commit massive atrocities, people escape, go to refugee camps, invade in different countries, it's a mess. So it's a rationale that. So still a sovereign state, limited for this idea of massive atrocities. That's it. That's it. And it's not invented by me, that's what's happening. But it's still, of course, the biggest country, they don't like this limit, because they feel no one can attack us. We can do it, and then we don't need the law to protect us. But you see, my point is, the ICC is not against the states. It's a product of the states. It's a product of sovereign states, which decided to do something different to protect themselves.
But still acknowledges in the hierarchy, in the hierarchy acknowledges that the state's self-definition is higher than the particular, or the
sovereign state is limited. There is no sovereign authority with the power to kill massive number of people. That's the limit. It's a limit. And it's a consequence of the history of the last century. Maybe you disagree, but normally these countries, the blue countries, adopt this limit.
No question. This is something that we also talked about yesterday. And in the presentation, basically you connected the dots between different historical moments in terms of the relationship between legality and history. And it was very moving to see how you connected with the prosecutorial universe, who basically gave the... So for us historians, it's even an incredible occasion for, you know, taking it asymptomatic of larger issues. I was wondering, one trial, which is important for us when we teach and write about the history of genocide and mass atrocities, is the Eichmann trial, which was absent from your presentation. So I wanted to ask you to reflect a little bit more on the Eichmann trial. Because there were important, very important moments in the history of genocide and its aftermath, right? Nuremberg,
that's true. We got put in the lines. Eichmann and Millet, but Eichmann is very important. Yeah, I agree with you. It was very important. Also, for Israel was very important.
But my point is, how, in your view, it sets a precedent or not in terms of all these connections?
I think all these trials is presenting this idea: people don't like to be killed. That's the basic concept, and they are trying to be protected. And that is expressed in a different way. And sometimes, when some conditions, suddenly it happened. And Catherine Sikin is showing there's a trend, consistent now, moving ahead. There are people who say, you know, this the human rights as utopia, Samuel Moyn, is presenting the idea, it's not stable. And maybe it's not stable. Maybe it's something that's happened in the last 50 years and declined. We don't know. We see what happened because we see what happened. But it's interesting because normally this idea of these values, people, US will feel our value, but the US was not in favor. And other countries were promoting. And I think something also I think you should focus, the historian guys, is on the role of music, rock, and movies in terms to create norms. Because I think were critically important. Woodstock, for our generation, was critically important. The Beatles were critically important. Because these guys were singing about peace, and that was creating the mantra. And the movies. You know, the New York Times started to call Holocaust with capital letter after the Nuremberg Judgment, and after two movies, Anna Frank and Nuremberg Judgment. So, I believe we need to, if culture, we need to understand how norms are adopted by society, and it's about cultural impact.
Perhaps the last question.
And Eichmann, sure. Yeah, and Anna Frank, talking about the new school,
Speaking of what you're saying, it's interesting. While the Holocaust was going on, the New York Times, a Jewish newspaper, essentially, controlled by Jewish families for a century, not once was it reported the bombing of Auschwitz. Was never reported on the front page of the New York Times. It only showed up on page 8. And I wondered about that. I found that so reprehensible.
But, yeah, I think it's correct what you say. It's how our people are thinking in normative ways. In those days, the discussion was about winning the war. It was not about protecting the Jewish. And you know, there were the Americans knew about the final solution, and they had meeting to discuss, and they say we can do nothing, and there is no way to bomb Auschwitz to stop the massacre in Auschwitz. They were saying, they were denying, they were refusing. The Americans and the British refused to bomb Auschwitz to stop during the war. And the people at Auschwitz, they saw the planes on their heads doing nothing. And I have a New York Times. You remember the Crystal Night when the Nazis were destroying the synagogue? The New York Times, the next day, present the person who will stop the conflict, the person who will be the control, the problem, was the person who produced the problem, Goebbels. Yes, the New York Times title is Goebbels will halt the problem, halted the problem. Because that's normally that happens. In Sudan, the UN was making deal with Harun because they like to make deal with the bad guy because the bad guy controlled the situation. So Goebbels was the guy who controlled, according to the New York Times, controlled the riots. Yeah, that's why we need historians to put things in perspective. But now we have to do faster. Okay.
Because you were talking about music and movies, so I understand that you were also talking about the symbolic. And I think the ICC plays a very important symbolic role here. If we think about these white countries and we get disappointed, say, oh, we cannot arrest people in those countries. But when you have a big fish like Israel concerned about the creation of a Palestinian state, also because of the Palestinians who they enjoy the ICC, and you know they could be somehow prosecuted. I don't think that Netanyahu is thinking that he can, you know, go to jail. I mean, it's very unlikely. But it has a symbolic role in that, as Andrew was saying about when Sarkozy makes a decision. Of course, the norm plays a role in that decision. So why can the ICC also assume that? That's also when I mentioned at Ruth Tito's book launch, this idea of a global truth commission. So you detach punishment from this role of attributing responsibility, of holding perpetrators accountable, irrespective of the capacity of punishing them or not. So this could enhance the symbolic role the court plays. How many people were arrested until now? Like two, right, by the ICC? Or two people?
I'm sorry, you have to go back. No.
No, how
seven.
Many?
No, I think there are 10 now.
10.
You know, there are 32 persons indicted, just 8 fugitives, okay?
Okay.
They're in jail, a president of Cote d'Ivoire, the vice president of Congo, Thomas Lubanga, Kerman Katanga.
They were all sentenced and...
No, convicted are just two.
Two, okay.
Katanga and Lubanga. But in jail, okay. Also so waiting for trial...
Only two convicted. But
it's a mistake.
Rose is amazing.
But it's not symbolic, it's normative. It's not symbolic, it's normative.
The normative is symbolic.
It's more than normative, because when Kenyatta went to the court, it's not symbolic. He went to when Bosco Ntaganda surrendered himself to the court. Imagine that. He was the king of the kibbutz, and he surrendered himself to the court. It's not symbolic. He's in jail. So, and also I would say the music and the movies are not symbolic, are more than symbolic, are massive creator of norms. And we need to understand that. probably following you, what I'm trying to present is legal norms are not the only norms. There are other norms. And instead to think in binary terms, legal and illegal, we need to think that, okay, these are legal norms, we are important, not define everything, but are a factor. In particular, something people know that the legal system creates power. When they appoint me prosecutor, they give me an incredible amount of power. It's not symbolic, it's real power. And that is what the legal system is creating. Not just because the prohibition, it's because it establishes a structure of power. And that is different than the social norms. But social norms are created by cultural, the songs and the movies are creating culture. And the Facebook now, you are disseminating. And also other things are happening. My feeling is, what is happening in the 21st century, your generation, the 20, you're born after the end of the Cold War, you're born for you it's normal to have internet and cell phones. And then for you, young people are your group around the world. No? And I think it's new, it's happening. All this is happening, and we need to understand that with a different frame, not just expecting one single idea will define everything. I like the idea how to present there are different norms in contradiction fighting within them. And, yeah, okay, we'll do two questions. Okay, very, someone is coming here?
Sorry?
Someone is coming?
Yes.
Wait, come on. Wait.
A song that produced norms, but they don't reflect the current status of what's going on in the world. So, there's a lot of examples of where cultural in the sense that, you know, works of art do not are examples of where you can escape the process of things. So we should look to artists who are responsible for accurate and sensible ways of inhabiting the world. Because you're right in terms of these norms, but that means that the artist has a lot more responsibility than you think, than it's thought, not you generally.
You feel guilty?
I feel guilty.
Yeah. What else?
You mentioned the technological advancements, and I guess, you know, a lingering question for me is that the world is changing at that certain breakneck speeds in only developed nations. So, you know, as you said before, there are countries that are without the popular vote, just as there are, like, slower technological developments. So, in that idea of there being change based off of the connection
of Facebook and all that sort of stuff. I mean, how do
you account for that sort of inequality, especially in nations where that's not the case?
Yeah.
Is that clear?
Well, you say internet is...
There's technological differences.
Yes, I know.
Yeah.
I'm not pretending that... Like, yeah, the power, yeah, there are different in power and money. The other day, I don't know, I have another quote. I was in, it was a journalist telling me, he quoted a report from, I think, US Bank, saying the wealth of 86 individuals is equal to the wealth of 3.5 billion persons in the world. Imagine disparity. Talking about disparity. Yes, so we have to fix that. But
I mean, it sort of, for me, it's a part of the uncertainty and a lack of optimism in regards to our generation making some version of change.
But it's not optimist, it's needed. It's about your survival, guys. I'm not saying you should do it because you're nice. You will die if not, okay? That's my point.
Yeah.
Like it, oh, I would be totally
catastrophic. She's saying that because of resources, the West or specific regions, they're able to create this change and manifest it faster because they have access to these resources rather than other countries that don't have the same access. Yeah. If that makes sense. So, like, not every child has a computer or has a cell phone the same way that we do. So we have the ability to move faster and implement what we want.
Yeah, so I'm not necessarily getting your idea that because we are...
Okay, but then you can do something for... But that is funny. Look, Invisible Children, you know Invisible Children? These are a group of three kids from San Diego who did movie about what happened in Uganda. They went there, they were crazy, they decided to save these kids in Uganda, and they were doing these movies to show the problem and propose. But then when they were so viral with the COVID-19, 120 million in 6 days, 1 million people were furious with them. NGOs and most of the political science people were furious with them. And that's life. But they were changing the world in Uganda, whatever. And you had to come to see Lemkin's story. Lemkin is this Jewish guy who invented the word genocide and died badly, but he moved the world. So, what you're telling me, the world is unfair? Yes. It's difficult to change? Yes. So?
Do you think on some level the ICC also creates some form of transparency in developing countries so that the leaders, if brought forth of the developing countries, would show association with the other ones? If that makes sense.
ICC is creating deterrence, the idea to use to gain power or retain power committing massive atrocities. That's the thing ICC could do.
But like in the case of like Kenyatta or like Laurent Gbagbo, like when brought to trial, then they have to show their relationships to other countries. So do you think that like provides more transparency for the developing world? Like in the case of Bashir in China?
Everyone knows the connection between China.
Yeah.
Transparency is there. The information is there. The meaning is what we... For me, that's the problem. In the world today, there's information, everything is there. But to connect the dots. And that's your job, guys. And it's about survival. And I'm pessimist. Okay? Bye.